guidance for the schools, the regulations, which say specifically a little more specifics about what the schools need to do, and that was out of date. And so although we were following those regulations, some of the guidance we had didn't really connect to that, so that was really why we decided we need to work on this some more and get this revised. And because we didn't have to revise the actual policy, we did not have to go in front of the Board of Education and present it and allow it to be open for discussion for three meetings, which was part of what I think slowed down the process to begin with, because it's just a long, tedious process. But in order to adjust regulations, you have to get the superintendent's approval and sign off. So that was what we ended up doing. And kind of off the screen, but again, why we decided to update it was because it hadn't been updated since 2006, and we really wanted to make sure that we were complying with federal and state regulations, but that we were also giving accurate guidance to the schools, and that we were aligned with other policies. So as other policies got updated within CMS, this policy hadn't, and so they weren't connecting well when people would look for resources to guide what they needed to do at the school. So this PowerPoint was created when we were presenting our revisions to the learning community superintendents. Ann Clark asked us to present to them first before she gave us approval, because she wanted them to have some input and give us some guidance. And so we use this because there were several areas that this policy covers, and I'm not an expert in all of these areas. So I'm in school health, but there's also a whole lot of child nutrition. There's a lot of physical education, health education, physical activity. And so we had people from both of those groups come with us, and Aaron as well joined us for the policy and prevention health department perspective. So what we ended up doing is pulling a smaller group out of the larger school health advisory council to do the nitty gritty wording changes and looking at the state and federal policy to make sure that what was in those requirements was easily or somewhat easily understood in this policy. So it's broken down, the policy is broken down by these four areas, and that's sort of what I'm going to go through, is those areas and where the changes are significant. Some of it was just wording changes, some of it was referenced to 2006, 2007. So some of it was just editing simple things, but the significant things I tried to note, and I have a copy of the original policy with the red lines too, if anybody's real technical and wants to see the specific changes. And I have the policy because some of the wording, like I don't know the specifics of why you have to say it a certain way to comply with the USDA, but Margaret was able to say, you have to say it this way. And so I try to read that part. So we have the implementation and monitoring and review of the policy, and that incorporates the oversight from the School Health Advisory Council at the district level, and then school health teams at the school level, and it also incorporates staff wellness, which we'll talk a little bit about. The next section is related to physical education and physical activity. We added a new section for health education. In the original document, there was a section on nutrition education, which is a subset of the health education. And it wasn't an emphasis in the schools, so we felt like health education was more of a hot button and needed more guidance and more specifics written out into the policy. So we added that. And then nutritional quality of food and beverages, that incorporates the vending, school meals, non-vending, classroom celebrations and rewards. So there's a lot in that section. And as I go through this, if you have a specific question, don't hesitate to interrupt me. I'm fine to take questions as we go.
When you talk about the classes, the different types of students, are you talking about internal classes, including in the curriculum in the school, or you can get some external providers to come and teach these classes to the students?
As far as the health education, the health education is curriculums within the schools. Sometimes they have somebody come in, they have contracts with outside providers that come in and do some of that as well, but a lot of the health education curriculum is taught specifically by the health teachers. Can I answer the question?
Yeah. Because I know, like, I work with the Bean Cancer Institute. We have a program for students from K, kindergarten to up to 12, and sometimes we find a little bit of resistance to, like, provide these classes, and we have a nice curriculum to develop it by a nutritionist, and so why is it so hard to get to the student? It's a base, you know, this is a research base, and it's a great opportunity for the students, and sometimes it's really hard to get in.
I think some of it has to do with the essential standards that the schools are required to follow and the curriculum that they already have in place. But we can talk maybe afterwards about ideas that, or people. Sometimes it's knowing who to talk to about the curriculum.
I know.
So they
system.
Yes, exactly. So first I'm going to talk about the monitoring and oversight piece of the policy. And this is the School Health Advisory Council, is the district oversight group. And this group, originally, we were guided by the coordinated school health model, which was the accepted model back in 2006. And recently, a new model called the whole school, whole community, whole child model replaced the coordinated school health model, because that model was purposefully bringing public health and education together, whereas the coordinated school health model was really just focused on school health, and there was a lot of missing pieces that needed to come together. So we had started adopting this model, the WISC model is what we call it, a couple years ago, and we realized while coordinated school health has a lot of those components in it, the WISC model separates things out more. It purposely includes community and policy in the model. I don't know if you can see it in this here. Red light doesn't work, but communities around the outside of, and the students at the center of the lens, where we're all trying to work together to have a positive impact. So we had already decided we were adopting this model. We were incorporating it into the wellness policy. And then last year, the North Carolina Board of Education came out and said that they were also adopting this model. And so we decided that was another impetus for us to say, okay, we really should update this policy and add this model to the policy, because we have not only our internal support, but the state level support and agreement with this policy and with this model. So we added that to this section on the School Health Advisory Council. We also added a little language related to the structure of our SHAC, so that it talks about who within the community might be included in our council, and how we structure it with a steering committee to help give us a little accountability and support within the school system. So just as the SHAC is a district level group that guides the monitoring of this policy, school health teams are the school level iteration of that. So school health teams really work to implement health initiatives within the schools, and they're tasked with oversight of the policy in some ways, but they haven't had a lot of ability to hold the schools accountable for staying in compliance with this policy, and so that's something that we've been trying to work on as well. And the These school health teams were already written into this policy, but we just made some minor word changes to try to give a little more support to them at the school level. And the big change that we did with the school health teams was we did add a section that says that we actively engage students in school health teams with at least one youth participant on the team. And we talked a little bit about this, about what that means and what that looks like at different school levels, because in elementary schools, we may not have a young student in the team participating the same way we might at a high school or middle school. But we purposely put that in because we want the schools to really try to get student input and get student involvement at whatever level they are. And so we felt like it was important to leave it in as is and not have specifics about, you know, a student on the team or a student at a certain age level or grade level. And then there's a section on staff wellness practices. And really that was also already there. We didn't make substantive changes to that. We added some language to support wellness and talk about staff as role models for students. Although that was implied in some of that staff wellness, it wasn't explicitly written out in that policy before. So we made sure that we pointed out that the idea was that we want healthy staff so that they can support students and be healthy role models and, you know, avoid burnout for the staff as well. So we tried to add some prevention and wellness language to some of the chronic illness that we focused on with staff. And that we still have, staff wellness is a subcommittee of our SHAC because we want to, again, promote that in our School Health Advisory Council as well. In the policy, we mention professional development around chronic illness in the schools that might relate to staff and students, and hopefully we can incorporate some prevention messages in some of those professional development opportunities for staff as well. So that's the end of my expertise, and these next areas are other people's expertise, so I will do my best to provide you with insight on what we did, why we did it, and direct you to the right person if you have really complicated questions. So this next section is related to student physical education and student physical activity. And what we did with this section was we increased the emphasis on the State Board of Education policies that were already in place. So there were already policies saying that students needed to have physical education by a trained teacher, they needed health education by a health teacher, but we didn't have some of that language in the policy. And so we really wanted to focus on making sure that we did include some of that. Also, there is a statement in the state policy about physical education classes having comparable class size to other core classes. And so while we knew that that was a rule, it wasn't in the policy, so we added it to make sure that the emphasis was there. So with physical activity, there is North Carolina state policy, some of you may be familiar with, called the Healthy Active Children's Policy, and that has been in place. And again, we've been required to follow that policy, but the language was not necessarily there in this policy. So what we did do is try and clarify some of those requirements and so principals have to sign off every year that their schools follow these regulations, and we have that written into the policy as well, that they are attesting to this every year. And some of the things that they have to sign off on are these listed here, that no teacher will take recess away as a form of punishment, or no teacher will make physical activity a punishment, and that a minimum of 30 minutes of moderate to vigorous activity is supposed to be provided for all students K through 8, and that is not supposed to take the place of physical education class or because they have PE, they don't have to do this. This is supposed to be completely independent. Yes.
I have two quick questions about this. One is, if a child doesn't finish their work, does that count? Can they have recess taken away to finish their work? Number one. And number two, if a teacher says you do not deserve recess, I'm going to have you walk laps. Does that fit in under severe and or inappropriate exercise?
Yes.
Okay.
Both of those things.
Okay.
And do they happen in the schools? Yes. Okay. My own children come home and tell me those things, and I'm like,
But they're not supposed to, and that's a North Carolina state policy.
Yes.
And I think it's just lack of awareness that principals
yes.
don't know.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So, and I will say, it's not necessarily that principals don't know about this policy. They don't know the specifics of what's happening and some of those gray lines. I was at a meeting with the North Carolina DPI, and they're the ones who get these reports, and you know, each principal has to sign off saying no teacher withholds recess or whatever. And they even acknowledge, we know that even if there's one teacher in that school that does it, if somebody's completely aware of that, then they may not be in compliance with this regulation. And it's not to, you know, they're not gonna get, as my boss says, their birthday taken away, but you know, they're not, it's to increase that awareness
yeah.
and to move towards other options.
Great.
But it still does happen, we do know that. The other section that we added was related to active transportation. We added something saying we encourage and support safe, active ways to get to schools, such as walking or riding bikes. Again, it's not always feasible. In some areas, I know my elementary school in my neighborhood, just it's not a super busy road, but there's not sidewalks, and there's not really easy crosswalks. So I think for little kids, they might be more cautious about that. You know, if it was a middle school, maybe they'd feel a little better about it, but they still have hesitations because of that safety issue.
Can I just mention one thing about that the language was really helpful here, because we have folks on our team that work on safe routes to school, and what they were finding is that some principals were saying, nope, we can't do that here. Mm-hmm. That regardless of the safety factors, regardless of opportunities for improvement, they were just putting the X on it because they didn't want to deal with it.
Yeah.
So at least this new language that the active routes and the safe routes to school employees can say, well, actually the policy says you should encourage it. So it at least gives them some
Yeah.
You know, again, it's not guaranteed, but it was huge. It was a huge win in their eyes to even have that to support the work that they're doing. So
I know. They were worried.
So the doors are glad.
They were worried it was going to get taken out.
Yeah.
So we were
I think they started with about 5 pages.
Yeah.
And whittled down to that.
Yes. And I'm glad you pointed that out, too, because there are a whole lot of other CMS board policies that cover other areas. So this is student wellness, and it's very broad. It covers interpersonal stuff. It covers some social and emotional health. It covers some alcohol, tobacco prevention, and health education. But this is not the only policy. So there's a whole policy. They had some language about the idling of cars and things. And they have policies upon policies that have bigger topics specifically. And so some of the language that we got pushed back on was because, well, that's already covered in another policy, and you don't want to contradict each other or say something in this policy, but know that people follow that policy for those types of things. So thank you for reminding me about that. So health education. Health education is one of those that has its own policy. There is another policy on comprehensive health education curriculum. And so there's already a whole lot of other resources out there related to making sure those curriculums are evidence-based, evidence-informed, and specifics around reproductive health and health and safety education, because that's a hot topic with health education. So in this policy, in the regulation revision, one of the things we did was we did reference House Bill 88 from 2009, which is the Healthy Youth Act, that changed some of the legislation around, specifically around reproductive health and safety education. moving away from the more abstinence only to abstinence based encouraged curriculums. So CMS does not have an abstinence only health education policy. Of course, when we talk about health education and reproductive health, we talk about how abstinence is the only 100% safe thing to do in that situation, but that's not the only thing we talk about. We do talk about comprehensive sex ed as well. So we had to update because that was an update for us as well. Thanks. In addition, we specified some of the things that had been updated in those standards, which requires reproductive health and safety to start in seventh grade. We also do some of that basic knowledge in fifth grade. And so there's some professional development around who teaches those courses, who teaches that stuff. And then the other piece that was relatively new that we added in was graduation requirements related to healthful living credits, and a very recent requirement for all students to be CPR trained before they graduate as well. Nutrition. So for the nutrition section, child nutrition already had a ton of requirements that they were already meeting, and they were well aware of the requirements. They had some requirements that would be state standards that were higher than federal standards, so they'd go with the state standards. Or there would be federal standards that were higher than or more stringent than the state standards, so they'd go with them. So there was a lot of different standards that they followed already, but some of it wasn't specified in this policy. So we did make sure that we noted that child nutrition followed national school lunch and breakfast programs. And so we updated language where it was needed. One place we didn't need to update it was the school meals section. They had already covered what they needed to cover with the school meals section. But we did update some of the language in the other sections to reflect USDA requirements, around, especially around vending and non-vending sales, excuse me, and rewards and class celebrations. So, what does that say at the top? It says USDA's all food sold in school. So we do follow the USDA's all food sold in school standards, and we follow the smart snack nutrition standards as well. And what we did change in the policy with this section was no competitive food sold until the last student has lunch was the way the regulations were written back in 2006. Now the requirement is it must state 30 minutes after the end of the school day. So no competitive foods can be sold until 30 minutes after the end of the school day. So technically those vending machines pop on after school.
I have a question. So yeah. Is there leftover food that goes to waste in CMS schools? And if so, what's
50%.
Yes, there definitely would be leftover school food that goes to waste. I know a lot of schools have recycling and composting programs that they're trying to do, but some of the people in this room may be more familiar with some of that than me. Mm-hmm.
Can it be provided to students?
Yeah, that's what I'm...
In what way?
Can they take it out? Yeah.
There's a... Can't do it. That goes against the federal guidelines. So when you take federal dollars for a meal, you can only get credit for that meal once. So you could donate that food to shelters. You could donate it to churches. You could donate it to those types of organizations. But you can't send a student home that you think that might need it because that singles that student out and shows a light on their situation. So you can't really do that.
But it, so it's not from a safety standard of
no,
like
it's a federal,
the kid was not gonna heat the food up. It's not. It's yeah. more so. You don't want to single that student out.
You don't want to do anything that singles out a student situation in any way according to the federal regulations.
And you can't double dip.
Exactly. So you can't get credit for that meal that you would be sending home. So
there are some communities that are doing some creative projects with this. So there are people working on workarounds. So I'd love to talk with you about that, Amanda.
And there's also some stuff. I'm sorry. There's a lot of schools that try and do the grab-and-go type food that kids can take with them so that they can take something for later as well.
Mm-hmm. That's what I was going to say. Instead of doing like a singling out program, could you just offer the opportunity and then it's kind of like and they come and they can get it. That way it's not like you're getting a checkbox. Mm-hmm.
You know. Somebody, if it's going to be separate from the school lunch, then you know, from a child nutrition standpoint, it's going to be their two things are going to be cost and labor. So they don't have money to pay for the labor to do it, and they don't have money to absorb that extra cost. However, when we get to my presentation,
way to put that plug in there.
It's a beautiful plug. I'm going to be $10. So I'll address what I'm working on in that area. So it's. It'll work out. And then in this new regulation, the 30 minutes after the school lunch school day, that's defined as the last school bell. So if it's a high school, it's usually about 2:45. But the school day was defined as starting at midnight. So it is the law when they passed this was pretty strict. So it's less than 200 calories, less than 200 milligrams of sodium, less than 10% fat. So when you see a bag of Doritos, it's not your bag of Doritos that are in the store. So it's whole grain. It meets these stringent nutritional regulations. You know, if it's a beverage, it can't be a certain size. It can't be, it can only be 100% fruit juice. No, depending on that, there's a bunch of things. Hey!
Yeah, you already covered it. There's a question back here and then over here.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask about the definition of a competitive food. Is it strictly what's in the vending machine, or is it foods that are sold at lunchtime that
anything
are not part of the meal?
Anything
like
that's sold. Anything that is sold to a student that is not coming from child nutrition services.
Yeah.
That's competitive.
Okay. So as long as child nutrition services is selling it.
Yeah.
While we're on the topic of vending machines, unless I'm reading this wrong, it appears that in the high schools, they can have artificially sweetened sodas.
And so, thank you for the segue. Because CMS vending sales, while I, as somewhat of an outsider to the child nutrition world, did not think this was going to be a meaty discussion. We went back and forth with the legal department. We went back and forth with my chief officer, and thank God for Margaret and Angela to be able to step in, and we crafted some wording to cover the guidelines, because what we wanted to do was make sure that what we say in the policy was something that we could enforce and that was realistic. And those things were hard to do, but what we ended up with was that you said it exactly, that no sugar or artificially sweetened sodas can be offered for sale at any time in vending machines available to students. Diet sodas basically are allowed for high school students, but not for middle school students. For middle school students, what we landed on was the lower calorie beverages, so a Powerade, a Gatorade, a tea or lemonade type beverage with up to 40 calories per 8 ounce or 60 calories per 12 ounce may be sold in 12 ounce portions. And again, for high school, lower calorie beverages, diet sodas or those same Powerade, Gatorade, tea type beverages with up to 40 calories per 8 ounce or 60 calories per 12 ounce may be sold in up to 12 ounce portions.
Unless it's artificial sweetened.
Right. No changes were made to the requirements related to the bottom, having, no changes were made to having water available, not selling any peanut products in the vending machines, and all the other nutritional requirements that he mentioned as far as the percentages of all those different nutritional items in the food. Yes.
Sorry, are there also like gluten-free and non-dairy options that are easily marked for certain kids that may have a higher food allergy issue?
So this is vending machines.
Right.
Are you talking about vending machines or in the cafeteria?
With both.
So what was the question?
Sorry, if there's like readily marked, like easily marked, like gluten-free and non-dairy, just like a higher, I'm sure there's more students all of a sudden, not just a peanut issue, but like a gluten issue.
We don't actually have a labeling system.
Okay.
Again, segue. What CMS, how they control allergens is basically at on the lunch line. So you would submit documentation noting your allergies for your child. It would be entered into the system. As that child comes through, they would put their ID number in and it would pop up on the screen, no strawberries or gluten-free or whatever the case may be. And then if that person that's running the register would then make sure that student doesn't have those items on his tray. If it does, then they would go back and kind of help them make the right choices or provide the right item.
Now that has to be through a diet order.
Correct.
So it's a form that has to be documented and signed off on by the doctor.
Yep.
So if you have a preference for your child to not eat
pork
or red food coloring or whatever.
Okay.
Somebody else have their hand up before?
So I know that the vending machines have some requirements, but what are students allowed to bring to school? Because they are not allowed to have sugar-sweet beverages, but a few weeks ago, school health nutritionist, and I was sitting with the counseling session, and the student had a giant bottle. So I'm just wondering what the policy is.
Not
they're not allowed to sell it.
No, we're not allowed to sell it, but yeah,
we can't
regulate them.
That comes from home.
So, you know, I get a lot of conversation around nut-free schools and food allergies again, and we can't limit what one student could bring because of another student for their access to free and appropriate public education. So, again, what you can sell, the waters, the milks, the fruit juices. Non-vending sales, so other non-vending sales or fundraising, what we wrote into the policy was to encourage the smart snack standards to be followed in those concession stands or outside of the school day activities, fundraisers. We also wrote in to encourage healthy options in general outside of the school day, but we did not have any hard and fast rules related to that. Rewards and class celebrations was another area of a lot of dialogue. So the old language, we had encouraged not to use food as a reward, and now we not only encourage them to offer healthy alternatives to food and beverages as a reward, we tried to give them some handouts, lists of alternatives to providing food as a reward for parties or celebrations. And in addition to that, some of us wanted to say you cannot do it, but because there's not a regulation saying that we cannot, that the schools were resistant to it from the get-go. So we felt like if we could get them on board and give them some healthy alternatives and suggestions, Healthy Active Children has some great resources about what ideas you can do for a Valentine's party that's different from just giving out candy. So we're trying to go at that angle rather than explicitly saying, no, you cannot do it, because in the end, we knew that they would. The other piece that we added was that schools could not prohibit students from purchasing certain items in the cafeteria. And that came from some information feedback child nutrition had gotten from different schools where staff would say, you're not allowed to have that, and they can't do that. Or they had some staff saying, no chocolate milk on Fridays or something like that. So they wanted to make it clear that they are not allowed to prohibit students from purchasing any a la carte items or anything in the school cafeteria. Yes, ma'am?
Can I ask a quick question about that? So two questions. One, can a principal say we're only work with a cafeteria manager and say we're only going to serve ice cream 2 days a week, or do they have to do that 5 days? I know of some schools.
Well, it's principal.
Principal driven.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. A lot of that, those decisions are principal driven, especially when it's centered around health.
And then I have parents who ask me this all the time. They say, I look at my child's, you know, receipt, you know, their PayPams,
yeah,
and it says Doritos and ice cream, and I'm wondering why they're coming home with a lunchbox full of food.
Mm-hmm.
Can I, you know, the parents say, can I ask the cafeteria, or can I put a note? Is the only option to have no money on their account?
No,
or
you can actually put a note in the system that says,
look at you, hey.
No pressure, right?
No, yeah, you can put a note into the system that says you restrict your child's consumption or whatever your product is. So if you don't want them to spend money on a la carte items, then you can instruct that.
Cool.
I would also encourage those families to talk with their students as well, because, you know, we get a lot of, again, with the food allergies, we get a lot of the families who want and no nut school, and I get their concern, but I also want them to understand their child is going to have to live in the world. And so helping them gain those skills as to navigate what is okay and isn't is part of what needs to happen as well. Not to say that you shouldn't say, I don't want my child to have that, because I think that's reasonable as well, but sometimes I get those parents that are really frustrated and blaming the school, and I feel like it's a partnership. We all have to come together and say, let's teach the kids how to make the healthy choices.
That's great.
So like I said before, some of the stuff that was emphasized or was not emphasized, we talked about some things that we took out of the policy because they were not requirements. And there are so many things that are requirements, we felt like it would water down some of our ability to hold people accountable if we were fighting every single battle, like the diet sodas in the high schools, where we knew that high school students could step out to the convenience store and buy their own. So there are some things that we would like to have had in there, but we took out because it was, whether it was a political battle or an argument between two groups because it wasn't a requirement, or that there are other policies that cover some of that stuff. So, what other questions do you guys have?
What does CMS do to try to ensure that each school has an active wellness team?
Excellent question. In the policy, they are required to have a school health team.
Mm-hmm.
And they also, the principals have to complete a school improvement plan, and school health teams are a subsection of that. And so that is designed to help them ensure that it is there. One thing our school health advisory council has been talking about is how do we hold them accountable for that. So the past 2 years, we were working with the superintendent came to me and said, you know, we have to attest to having these recess requirements. I want to know, do they have these school health teams? And so we added it to the DPI attestation form that the principals have to sign off on, saying, we do have a school health team. some of what we did with this policy was writing in some of the ways that we can hold them accountable. And we're gonna try to use our shack to help support and promote those school health teams. Last year, I had someone work with me to identify all of the team leaders in every school. And that helped us, one, know if they had a team. And it was very interesting. It was way more interesting than we thought it was gonna be, because we find out this person is the designated team leader, and then when we called the team leader, they were like, I don't know what that team is. So we realize that there's a lot of work to do, but we are still committed to making sure that those teams are working and supported. So what we want to do is just continue to increase the awareness around those teams and increase some support. Because what I've found when I've gone out to schools who say, my principal's freaking out because they said we have this team and we don't have one, what do I do? But the more I started talking to them, they had initiatives that they were focusing on, you know, a heart healthy walk 1 month, or, you know, the staff were doing a water drinking challenge or something. So there were things in place. It's just getting that common language, that shared language, and the support, you know, so that they understand from the district level they have support for these things, and it is important, because what ends up happening is academics or testing or whatever takes the front seat, and people feel like, I'm a champion, but my school can't handle it, and so there's only so much I can do. And so we've also been talking about that message of healthy students actually learn better. You know, that's how we sort of get our foot in the door.
Yes, that's the question that I have. How did you measure the impact of these school teams?
So there are some, there's some anecdotal data that the schools can use. There's also the Youth Risk Behavior Survey that the middle and high schools complete every 2 years. And that asks about nutrition, physical activity, health education, sex, sex drugs, all the. Well, they do it every 2 years. So they can look at where, how the answers were in 2015 compared to 2017, and see what we're trying to do is get some of that information about what the schools are doing in those teams, so that we can look at what their initiatives have focused on. We did a little survey last year asking them about what their top goals for their team were, and they centered around these things. You know, physical activity, nutrition, staff wellness, and health in general. So we're definitely on the right track. We just have more work to do.
Thank you so much. So Monica, I'll let you ask the question, but that's one of the reasons you're here, is when we started the Fresh Look at School Food collaboration, one of the first topics that came up was wellness teams and the fact that, you know, maybe less than half of the schools have them. How can we work together to make sure all of the schools have one? And that, you know, is one of the first pieces that had come up as kind of a to-do item almost. And where can we embolden our partners, motivate our partners to, we're all at different schools in different capacities. Mm-hmm. And so we saw that as, you know, kind of a great use of this collaborative group.
Yeah.
And then hence your invitation to come and present the update today.
I have other data on this school health team survey, so that I can, maybe some other time I can come and share that.
That would be great.
Yeah. Well, that was my question. I was asking if the survey data can be broken out by school, and then you can see if the results are tracking with the changes that they're making in the team.
So the surveys that we did last year can be broken out by school. We have some weighted data from the Youth Risk Behavior Survey, but it's not school specific. But we also have local data for the Youth Risk Behavior, and then we have state data and national data as well. So we can see where we stand.
But that's kind of county by county,
the
behavior.
Yeah.
So Monica, thank you.